how's it going? Welcome to the show.
It's the show.
I'm Scott Horton. This is my show, the Scott Horton Show. I can prove that because that's what it says right there at the top of the page at scotthorton.org. I'm streaming live from there. Also from noagendastream.com, from anomalyradio.com, a few other places. Alan Butler from Liberty Express Radio. He plays the show on a delay. Sometimes I get it to him late. Usually it's from 3 to 5 Eastern time there at Liberty Express Radio. Well, he's going to be on this show today, due to the fact that he's one of these guys who knows all about the central bank. I hate the central bank. Well, anyone who does know about it, but who's not in on it, hates it. That's basically the rule, I'm pretty sure. But anyway, so he's going to be on to talk about what the hell is going on with this stupid economy in a little while. And then Peter Ludlow is going to be on the show. He's a professor of something at some college or another, but he wrote this thing for The Nation about Barrett Brown, the journalist who the government put in prison for... they're trying to put in prison. Who I guess is being held without bail right now. Like he's some kind of serial killer or something. He's a journalist, but he was reporting on something that the government doesn't like. And so, he's in jail. And, yeah. You know, the charge, honestly, his charge is copying and pasting a link into a chat room. See, the thing is, there's no such thing as the rule of law. Certainly not in America. So, bottom line is, he made powerful people angry. And they have this ridiculous excuse called the law that they get to pretend they're invoking in order to lock the person that they don't like in a cage because they don't like him. It's pretty transparent. FBI, they're just the political police in America now. That's all they do. They run around entrapping little kids into terrorist plots. And they go after whistleblowers and journalists and other decent people that are, you know, one way or the other at cross purposes, find themselves at cross purposes with the powerful. Great job, guys. Except job one, making yourselves look good, you're failing horribly at that. Everybody's terrified of you. But we also all think you're a pathetic joke. Wow, yeah, did you hear about the time that Al-Qaeda was pole vaulting in my grandfather's basement? Yeah, well, the FBI agent told me to say that, so I said it. And so now I'm doing 20 years in a cage because I'm a terrorist. Because I repeated some made-up nonsense. Who in the world has ever heard of any basement anywhere having such a high ceiling you could pole vault there? I don't understand it. I've been in basements before, you know, I'm from Texas. Well, and in my part of Texas anyway, Texas is really big. My part of Texas anyway, it's all limestone down there. It's just not economically viable for everybody to have a basement. So we just don't do basements here. But I've been in basements before, you know. I've taken vacations to the Northeast where people have basements. I've never been in a Pakistani basement or an Afghan basement, but I suppose it's possible they have really, really, really high ceilings. But no, mostly I just think the FBI is a joke. That poor kid. I always forget his name, and I'm sorry about that. Because I always just call him that poor kid from Lodi, California. Hamid Hyatt, that's his name. Hamid Hyatt. who was a member of a small family, him and his dad. And their family was infiltrated by the FBI. Started calling the dad, Dad. Started acting like the long-lost older brother of the naive young boy. And then it was simply a matter of putting words in the kid's mouth, not even tricking him into doing anything. Just putting words in the kid's mouth and cashing checks. And the FBI paid this rat, the same rat who claimed that Ayman al-Zawahiri had done a grand tour around the West Coast raising money for Al-Qaeda back a year before 9/11 or something. Ridiculous liar. And they paid him hundreds of thousands of dollars. He tried to infiltrate the Pakistani community in Lodi, California. They didn't want anything to do with him. He had to settle for infiltrating a family. And entrapping a young kid, a minor, into saying, yeah, America does suck, you're right. Oh, that's providing material support for terrorism. Well, and also claiming that his grandfather lived in Kandahar, Afghanistan, where he didn't live, and trained Al-Qaeda on pole vaulting techniques in his gigantic high-ceilinged basement that he didn't have. That, and all this was just made up by the FBI agent. In fact, the LA Times at one point, I don't know if you can still find it at their website, but you can certainly find the article. There was a really long article on like the weekend edition of the LA Times one time that told this whole story of poor Hamid Hayat and his father. His father was indicted on trumped up charges too, but he got away with a deadlock, not an acquittal, but a hung jury. But they even included the video. Was leaked, you know, it came out, the defense, I guess, had the video from the trial, from the discovery, and there was the FBI agent saying, pole vaulting? Your grandfather taught them how to pole vault the Al-Qaeda guys? And the kid says, yeah, sure, pole vaulting. Is that what you want me to say? He's pole vaulting? Yeah, he's pole vaulting. Yeah, they're Al-Qaeda pole vaulting at my grandfather's house. It was all made up by the FBI agent first. Anyway, so they're a joke. When they're not entrapping poor Hamid Hayat and sentencing him to 20 years in prison for nothing, they're going after Bear Brown for being a journalist and saying in a chat room with other journalists, hey, guess what, guys? These hackers hacked Stratfor, and there's a bunch of information they've posted. Let's all go look at it together. What? Are you charging him with that? But I thought this was America. Oh, no, this is the homeland. Anyway, it's ridiculous. And I like Bear Brown because I've interviewed him a couple of times. He's a good guy. And, you know, I never could understand a word he was saying when I interviewed him. That's not really true. It was hard, though. He had a really bad phone connection in Brooklyn. And it's very difficult to talk with him. But I did interview him a few times, and he's a good guy. And they're persecuting him for political reasons rather than prosecuting him for criminal ones. So, you know, Christian Stork at whowhatwhy.com has been doing some good journalism on this topic lately. Now here's some more. That's a pretty long introduction, I guess. Once I go off on a tangent about poor Hamid Hayat, it's hard for me to contain myself. That is just the most outrageous thing. Out of the 50 at least, outright entrapment cases. Right, we're not talking about just trumped up terrorism charges. You got hundreds and hundreds of convictions on trumped up terrorism charges. I'm talking about just the 50 that were outright entrapment jobs. Poor Hamid Hayat, he's the worst one. You know, like those idiots down in Miami, the Miami 7, who they thought that they were just playing this informant for money, but he was playing them for convictions and money. But they're not as sympathetic characters to me. They still all are 100% innocent. Not just not guilty, they are innocent of the charges against them. And the jurors that on the third try convicted them should be blasted off into the sun. Those are the guilty. Any jurors who would conspire with the prosecution to convict those guys in the case of the Miami 7. Horrible, terrible criminals. Guilty of conspiracy to kidnap and whatever other federal crimes. I don't know the exact statutes. Horrible jurors. Horrible people. What? You're putting them on trial for the third time, huh? You couldn't get two juries to convict any of these guys. So now you're bringing them to us. Well, don't worry. We'll go ahead and get your job done for you there, prosecutor, the jury said. But anyway, at least those guys were over 18. You know what I mean? At least those guys were gangsters. Not even real gangsters, but, you know, wannabe thug life types from crappy neighborhood in Miami, whatever. They didn't really seem like that bad of dudes. I don't know. But Hamid Hayat, he was just some poor kid. Hamid Hayat didn't do anything, man. He didn't do anything. From now on, I wish there was a way that I could, you know, just change the, you know how things become figures of speech, you know, like, oh man, here, we're totally Munson down in the middle of nowhere, you know, that kind of thing. It should just be the case that somehow, from now on, everyone just calls the FBI Hamid Hayat. You know, that becomes the new nickname for them. That becomes the term of endearment. You know, like we call them the feds. We call the Federal Reserve the Fed. We call a gaggle of FBI agents persecuting someone for political reasons feds. Well, let's all call them Hamid Hayats. So that everywhere, every FBI agent goes, he's ashamed. Or at least, you know, not made to feel ashamed because FBI agents aren't real humans with real feelings for anyone other than themselves, you know. But, you know, so that everyone will point and laugh at them. They'll at least be a little bit embarrassed, you know, even if they can't internalize it. And then, and just from now on, no one will ever be able to bring up any FBI agent in any context without them having to concede that, yes, they're guilty of conspiring to entrap and destroy the life of poor young Hamid Hayat, who never did anything to anybody. I mean, I guess we could all just call them the butchers of Waco, or we could call them the people who could not solve the Unabomber crime after 18 years until his brother handed him over on a silver platter. Or we could call them the guys who 9/11 happened on their watch. Or, you know, the heroic FBI agents who still have failed to solve the anthrax attacks that everybody knows Dick Cheney was behind the anthrax attacks. And all they can do is blame poor innocent Stephen Hatfield and poor innocent Bruce Ivins. And everybody knows they're lying. You know, the guys that burned the Branch Davidians' tiny little baby children to death. The same ones who 9/11 happened on their watch. The same ones who entrapped poor Hamid Hayat. The same ones who are persecuting poor Barrett Brown for being a journalist. Trying to put him in prison for being a journalist. Oh, and then, oh, I forgot. Barrett Brown once said to a YouTube, I'm gonna get you, FBI agent, which everyone concedes means I'm going to publish your private information online. That's all he meant by that. I'm gonna have some of my hacker friends put your junior high school report card on the internet, pig. That was what he said. That was his threat. But, oh, poor little FBI agent was just terrified to death. He peed all on himself. The FBI agent that Barrett Brown was threatening? Yeah, his son will never look him in the eye again. Because he started quivering and shaking and crying and pissing on himself. Like a terrified little bitch. And so, the entire force of the federal government is clamping down on Barrett Brown and pretending that his threat to dox, that's a verb, to hack your private information and post it on Scribd or something, right? His threat to dox this FBI agent, who after all had been messing with the guy's mother, somehow warrants a prison term. So, here's the FBI for you. When they're not politically persecuting journalists or whistleblowers, when they're not burning Branch Davidian's children to death or sitting around all of them with their thumbs up each other's asses as 20 real-ass Al-Qaeda dudes prepare to hijack 4 airplanes and crash them in America. When they're not entrapping poor Hamid Hayat and his father. When they're not otherwise coming up with ways to serve as the biggest practical joke on the people of this country. Then they're what? I don't know. Then they're covering for local cops who violate the civil rights of American citizens. That's what. What? A cop murdered somebody? Why, we better make this a federal civil rights case. Actually, we decide there's not enough evidence to continue investigating, so go ahead and go home. You're fine. Okay, good. Yeah, the Federal Bureau of Hamid Hayat. Poor Hamid Hayat. that's funny. All right. I'm sorry. I'm scared to death of the FBI. I'm not committing any federal crimes at all, guys. Please don't hurt me. And you know what? Nobody listens to me. So when I make fun of you, no one cares. They're not going to all start calling you Hamid Hayat from now on. So please don't trump up charges and persecute me or send the hostage rescue team to burn me and my family to death. I'm trying to just be a good American and criticize my government in defense of my country, you know? It just seemed like maybe if everybody thought of all of you guys as the schmucks who entrap poor Hamid Hayat, then maybe everyone would hate you as much as I do, and then maybe someday your agency could cease to exist and the American people could begin down that road toward freedom. Which is all I want for my fellow countrymen and women. I even think that the Branch Davidians should have been able to believe their stupid religion by themselves in peace. How do you like that? Yeah, sorry. For people in the audience and for concerned FBI agents, I'm never going to stop being pissed off about that Waco thing. Not ever. All right, I got a ton of news to cover, other than Barrett Brown's story today, so we'll get to that. Bradley Manning's still on trial. I don't know all the details. I should have got Nathan Fuller on or something to explain the details here, but it'll wait till next week. But they've gone from, I don't know what the hell. For now, at least, they've gone from testimony on the witness stand to pushing papers back and forth. I don't understand exactly what that means, but other than it's a lull in the courtroom drama, maybe it's a push to, to make moot the people's efforts to get transcripts of the daily proceedings. They wanted to keep this trial secret. They had to concede under the old pretensions of rules of laws that, I guess if you people raise the money and you pay for the court stenographers, then you can have a court stenographer come in the room. And that's the only reason we've got the transcripts that we've got so far. But anyway, so it's at least, it's a lull in the thing. I don't know whether the defense is really going to put on a case more than just, you know, the cross-examination of the government's witnesses that they've already done. And you know what? Maybe some of this pushing paper back and forth is the defense actually making their case. I don't really understand the details. I'll try to get a good expert on for you next week. There's very little good journalism about this except in the alternative media, and I can't keep up with it all, man. I got a busy life. What am I going to do? I'm trying. But the moral case for Bradley Manning is simple, and that is that, first of all, he had a sworn duty, a legal duty, to refuse to participate in the war crimes he was being ordered to participate in. He had every reason to believe, just as his superior officers told him, get back to committing them war crimes, I told you, that their superior officers would cover for them. He had every reason to believe that if he contacted his senator, that his senator would be in league with Satan. You know, figuratively speaking, and would have nothing to do with trying to help him or trying to get the story out. He tried to go to the New York Times. He tried to go to the Washington Post. They wouldn't return his calls. See, they weren't interested in what Bradley Manning had to reveal because he doesn't work for the White House, because he doesn't work for the Pentagon, and he's not there leaking classified information in order to make one of the American Empire's enemies look bad. He was leaking from the bottom up in order to show the truth of just how bad the American Empire is. So they didn't care. They didn't want to hear it. They didn't return his calls. So he called up WikiLeaks. And what is WikiLeaks? WikiLeaks is an online newspaper, dude. That's all they are. You can try to categorize them however you want with your, ridiculous secondary qualities and subjective categorizations and whatever, whatever. But what do? They receive classified information and they publish it, which makes them just like the New York Times and the Washington Post, except for the fact that they don't have as their one and only goal helping the American Empire demonize their enemies. They're actually interested in classified information that would make America's enemies or America look bad. If you look at WikiLeaks, it's not an anti-American organization. WikiLeaks published information. For example, they leaked all of Bashar al-Assad's emails. And that is obviously right in line with the American Empire's agenda. Hell, some conspiracists think the whole thing is a modified limited hangout, ignoring the fact that Manning only deliberately leaked secret and confidential level stuff and not top secret, most scandalous stuff. They ignore that and they glom on to, look at all the leaks that WikiLeaks has put out, all the documents that they've put out, all the secrets that they've revealed about countries like China that America likes scoring points against. Countries like Syria, which America is backing Al-Qaeda and their suicide bombing campaign against the government of Syria right now. So they're not an anti-American criminal organization there just to help facilitate anti-American espionage so someone can nuke your Grammy in her jammies in the middle of the night. No, they're just doing journalism, that's all. Julian Assange is Bill Keller, only with balls. That's it. There's no legal distinction there. It's just journalism. So what did Bradley Manning do? He liberated some truth that needed liberating after the military put him in the position of attempting to force him to participate in turning innocent people over to be tortured, including a man who simply was arrested for writing an essay. A man wrote an essay that even in America you could still write. I don't know, you couldn't get it published in the New York Times, but I don't think they would lock you in prison or torture you just for writing an essay called Where Did the Money Go? About Nouri al-Maliki or Barack Obama. Huh, where'd the money go? Well, somebody wrote an article like that about Nouri al-Maliki, and he was being turned over to be tortured. And Bradley Manning said to his superior officer, "Hey, superior officer, they're going to torture that guy, and I had the translator translate it, and all it says is innocuous op-ed newspaper stuff." And his superior officer said, "Yeah, that's right, get back to it. And help do it to more people, too." So he liberated the documents, he uploaded them to WikiLeaks. And what do they reveal? War crimes. What do they reveal? An American empire absolutely out of control. At least attempting to dominate every political government on this planet. With bribes and or bombs. Cooperating with people who boil people alive. Like in Uzbekistan. Or put drills in their eyeballs like in Iraq. Hiring child rapists to be the new government of Afghanistan. Supporting the right-wing coup leaders in, what, two or three different countries in Latin America. Lying all about their war in Yemen. And on 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 and on. 1,000 important stories. The corruption in Tunisia revealed by the WikiLeaks. Examined, not revealed, they already knew, but examined in detail in the WikiLeaks and published in Tunisia. That was the start of the Arab Spring. And the Arab Spring, if you look at it from, you know, Libya and Syria, where America is trying to hijack people's revolutions and turn them into, you know, short-circuit them and turn them into pro-American, pro-dictatorship type things, well, there's a lot to be desired there, obviously. If you want to look at America and Saudi Arabia's crushing and Bahraini crushing of the rebellion in Bahrain, then that would be a tragedy too. If you want to look at America getting rid of Saleh but just putting his cousin or best friend or whatever in charge down there in Yemen, okay. It hasn't been perfect. But in Tunisia, they overthrew their American-supported dictator. And in Egypt, they overthrew their American-supported dictator. And, you know, the Muslim Brotherhood, they suck. They're politicians. They're conservatives. They're not doing a good job over there, and everybody hates them. But you know what? At least they get to have regular elections. At least their military has been taken down a peg or two. Their officers, I mean, from being the rulers of the entire state. And even if the Muslim Brotherhood sucks, at least their increase in power in general means an increase in pluralism, in separate powers, public and private, in Egypt. And they got a long road to hoe, but you know what? Who supported their tyrannies for the past 35 years? The USA. And now the conspiracists who say, and I shouldn't call them conspiracists in a demeaning way or whatever, but I just mean people who assume that the entire Arab Spring is a big screw job by the CIA, I disagree with that. I think what happened in Tunisia and in Egypt were, in essence, very anti-American. Because after all, there would have never been a Mubarak. He would have fallen long ago if it hadn't have been for America backing him up this whole time. And Hillary Clinton, you know, and I don't think this is well-practiced lines being rehearsed and whatever. I think they were pretty blatantly desperate and terribly upset, and they didn't know what to do with losing, Mubarak. Oh, gotta go. Be right back after this. This is Scott Horton Show, scotthorton.org. Also, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, / Scott Horton Show. At least it's Friday, right? Hey y'all, Scott Horton here for The Future of Freedom, the journal of the Future Freedom Foundation. Every month, Plumline Individualist editor Sheldon Richmond brings you important news and opinions on policy by heroic FFF President Jacob Hornberger, hard-hitting journalist columnist James Bovard, and others from the best of the libertarian movement. The Future of Freedom tackles the most important issues facing our country, from the bankrupt and insane welfare and regulatory states, to foreign wars and empire, the dismal state of our economy, and ongoing assaults on civil liberties. This society needs peace and freedom. for prosperity to prevail. Subscribe to the Future Freedom Imprint for just $25 a year or online for $15 a year at fff.org/subscribe. And hurry up, because this summer they'll be running my articles about the wars in Libya, Syria, and Somalia in the Future of Freedom too. That's fff.org/subscribe for the Future of Freedom. And tell them Scott sent you. Over at AIPAC, the leaders of the Israel lobby in Washington, D.C., they're constantly proclaiming unrivaled influence on Capitol Hill. And they should be proud. The NRA and AARP's efforts make them look like puppy dogs in comparison to the campaigns of intimidation regularly run by the neoconservatives and Israel firsters against their political enemies. But the Israel lobby does not remain unopposed. At the Council for the National Interest, they put America first, insisting on an end to the empire's unjustified support for Israel's aggression against its neighbors and those whose land it occupies, and pushing back against the lobby's determined campaign in favor of U.S. attacks against Israel's enemies. CNI also does groundbreaking work on the trouble with evangelical Christian Zionism and neocon-engineered Islamophobia and drumming up support for this costly and counterproductive policy. Please help support the efforts of the Council for the National Interest to create a peaceful, pro-American foreign policy. Just go to councilforthenationalinterest.org and click Donate under About Us at the top of the page. And thanks. Hey y'all, Scott Horton here for WallStreetWindow.com. Mike Swanson is a successful former hedge fund manager whose site is unique on the web. Subscribers are allowed a window into Mike's very real main account and receive announcements and explanations for all his market moves. The Federal Reserve has been inflating the money supply to finance the bank bailouts and terror war overseas. So Mike's betting on commodities, mining stocks, European markets, and other hedges against our depreciating dollar. Play along on paper or with real money, and then be your own judge of Mike's investment strategies. See what happens at WallStreetWindow.com. Show here. I'm your host, Scott Horton. This is the Scott Horton Show. You can find my full interview archive at scotthorton.org. More than 2,800 of them now going back to 2003. Also follow me on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube at /Scott Horton Show. It's true, we can't be friends on Facebook because I'm over my limit, but you can subscribe to me, which, as far as I can tell, is the exact same thing. So there you go, Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube at /Scott Horton Show. And as I was telling y'all earlier in the day, from 3 to 5 Eastern time at LibertyExpressRadio.com, where I get to ride Peter Schiff's coattails there and pick up a whole hell of a lot of new listeners. I'm very happy to be on there. And the boss and the host of Butler on Business is Alan Butler, my new best friend in the world. Welcome to the show, Alan. How are you doing?
Hey, Scott, I'm doing good. It's always a great day to talk to my buddy,
Scott Horton. Well, there you go. Good deal. I'm very happy to have you on the show here. And now here's the thing of it. This guy, Ben Bernanke, the chairman of the Federal Reserve Open Market Committee, he gave a speech, and then, oh, my God, all the numbers started going up and down. What in the hell is going on?
You know, the thing that's perplexing to me, Scott, is that the street, as they've taken to calling the financial elite up there in New York, basically got what they wanted. Ben Bernanke said that he was going to continue printing the money. He was going to curtail printing the money. He may accelerate printing the money. I'm beginning to think that what we might be seeing now is a worldwide reaction to the fact that Bernanke, it is now beyond his control. Personally, if you look at the fiscal situation here in the United States, whether you and I like the money printing, and I am vehemently opposed to not only the money printing, but a privately owned banking cartel controlling our money, but the the deficits in this country are to the point now, coupled with the fact that the foreigners are not buying the treasuries anymore. Ben Bernanke and his cartel members just concluded purchasing 78% of all the net new treasuries issued since the beginning of this calendar year. They are on track to purchase 100% of all net new treasuries within the next few weeks. What we have going on now is the full monetization of the U.S. debt. So whether you and I like the idea that Ben Bernanke is printing money is beside the point. Ben Bernanke will have to continue to print the money because no one else is buying the Treasury debt. We are beginning to turn the corner. The end game is near, in my opinion. This is a totally unsustainable situation that we are in now.
Yeah, but you're smart. What about all these idiots on this Wall Street who heard everything they wanted to hear, but then the numbers all crashed anyway?
Well, what they are fearful of is that Ben Bernanke may actually slow down his destruction of the U.S. dollar. You remember, it's not you and I that are borrowing freshly printed dollars off of Ben Bernanke's printing press at 0%. It is the banksters. Mm-hmm. They're the ones that get that free money, not you and I. So if what they heard when he was all over the map, frankly, Wednesday, was that they may not be able to get as much of that free money as they otherwise were getting, now they're throwing their little temper tantrum. And I think like a spoiled child, they're going to throw this temper tantrum until Bernanke relents and says, you know what, I'll continue to give you fellas free money.
Well, now here's the thing, too. It isn't just because they're greedy and they like free money. It's because they still have gazillions of dollars worth of bad bets that need covering left over from the crash of 08, right?
Oh, absolutely. Which brings me to the next point. Bernanke, with his $85 billion a month, which calculates to over $1 trillion of new money every year, $45 billion of that per month is to buy mortgage-backed securities, toxic mortgage-backed securities. But he fails to mention who he's buying it from. You don't own any mortgage-backed securities. I don't own any mortgage-backed securities. The banksters own the mortgage-backed securities. So these bad assets, these toxic assets, Ben Bernanke is buying it from the cartel members with these freshly printed dollars. Now, the big question is, how can Ben Bernanke ever unwind his balance sheet? You know, there's talk that he's going to unwind the balance sheet, but who in their right mind is going to buy these toxic mortgage-backed securities off of the Federal Reserve? Who is going to buy treasuries off of the Federal Reserve? The answer is nobody. So this money does not get repaid. We, the American taxpayer, are going to be saddled with this via the inflation tax, and it's the inflation tax is the reason Congress allows a private corporation like the Federal Reserve to control the money supply. They're like Alfred E. Newman in Mad Magazine. What, me worry? They don't worry because they will be out of office when this bill comes due.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny because that was actually the argument that I first heard when I very first learned about inflation as a kid, that, you know, it's not perfect the way we have it with this separate independent central bank type thing. But geez, if you let Congress do it, they get reelected every 2 years. So they will only ever want to inflate, and they will never, ever, ever, ever want to take the punch bowl away. And if you have this separate independent Fed, at least they are supposed to be insulated from that kind of pressure and say, sorry, there's only so much we can inflate without completely, you know, screwing up every damn trade balance in the country or something and bankrupting everybody. And at some point, we have to knock it off. But what you're saying is, just from the corner that they painted themselves into, politics aside, you know, political pressure aside, just financial pressure dictates that they can't do anything except continue down the same path.
That is the way I see it, because the appetite for U.S. debt has disappeared. This whole notion that we're borrowing all this money from China is a smokescreen. China is a net seller of U.S. debt. That leaves one buyer, and he's buying with reckless abandon, and that is Ben Bernanke. And Ben Bernanke now holds, the Federal Reserve now holds, the largest collection of treasuries in the entire world. And the thing that I find most criminal about that behavior is that Ben Bernanke bought all of those treasuries with literally without one red cent. And now that he's buying all these mortgage-backed securities, the central bank, our Federal Reserve, is becoming America's largest landlord, and all of it without really one red cent.
Yeah. Well, and I keep seeing in the news that, hey, the housing market here, there, and the other place is doing really good. And, of course, they just look at it like, great, the economy is healed, I guess, because housing prices are up in a couple of places. But I see other news stories from time to time that say, oh, yeah, there's still, what, 16 or 20 million unoccupied houses in America right now, where the banks are redlining entire, well, that's not even the right word, because that word already has a specific meaning, but they're drawing lines around entire neighborhoods, I guess, and just keeping entire neighborhoods off the market where they're not even for sale at all in order to try to prop prices up instead of just letting them fall. Now anybody could afford a house if they just let the prices fall.
This so-called recovery in housing, the very investment firms, the very entities that unloaded all of these toxic houses onto Freddie and Fannie are now the ones buying them back. You know, what a great system if you're one of the financial elite. You can unload your bad bets on the American taxpayer at 100 cents on the dollar, and when the media is looking the other way and the American people are busy living life, now you're coming back in buying the very same properties for cents on the dollar. This, they're buying thousands of houses at a time for the purposes of renting these houses out to people in order to chase yield, because nobody's getting anything on their interest income. My friends that are tied to the housing industry, for example, the people in the lumber industry, that industry is still in a state of depression, Scott. The recovery is an illusion. In fact, this whole economic recovery has been an illusion. It's an illusion brought about by the deliberate understatement of inflation. If you understate the real rate of inflation, then you do, by extension, overstate all of the economic activity. If we counted inflation the real way, the way it was counted, even as recently as 1980, inflation is significantly higher than the official numbers that are coming out of the government.
All right, here's the thing now. You sound like me in the 1990s, and then again in the early 2000s. And of course, I'm a very vulgar Rothbardian, and I'm not one of you like real businessmen or economists or experts. I'm an anti-war guy. But I read Jekyll Island when I was a kid, and Griffin's economics are sound there, Misesian and Rothbardian economics there. So I was always saying, nah, come on, the 1990s, there's bankruptcies everywhere. The economy's really in shambles in a lot of places. People are hurting all over the place. All their jobs are being shipped away and whatever. And yeah, so the stock market looks good and the dot-com NASDAQ looks good and everything. But really, that's just inflation. Only instead of across-the-board price inflation, it's just inflating certain sectors, right? But then, so that those bubbles popped in 99 and 2000, right? So then in the early 2000s, everyone said, well, the economy's doing a lot better now, even in spite of the cost of the war. It's amazing. Somehow, I'm not really sure. But anyway, yeah, the economy's doing great. The stock market's up and the housing market's up and everything's fine. And I would say, yeah, but that's just inflation. I mean, if you owned, a trucking service that delivers fuel, I guess you're doing great because fuel prices are up. But that's just price inflation. Same thing for housing, same thing for food and whatever. But that's not really, economic growth. That's just, but it's not price inflation all the way across the board either. It's just in these certain sectors. So where some people say it looks like these sectors are doing good, I just see hot air, right? So here's what I'm getting at. I'm only talking this long for a reason, I swear. And that is that in this current era, most of the Austrians, not all of them, but most of the Austrian economists who very well pegged the housing bubble said that what they expected to come next, due to all the bailouts and all the Bernanke inflation, would not be a bubble in housing, a bubble in stocks, a bubble here, a bubble there. It would be a massive rampant inflation across the board of the money supply, and then price inflation across the board. And that hasn't happened. And now when I talk with Bob Murphy and then they say, well, yeah, because apparently Bernanke was listening, or maybe I'm making up that part, but at least Bernanke realized that there was a danger of that. And so he came up with this new trick, completely illegal, but he just made it up and went along with it and did it himself. And that was to pay the banks. He'd give them all the money they wanted, right? He'd give them $1 trillion, but then he'd pay them to keep that money at the Fed rather than turn around and loan it out to you or me for the new business we're trying to start. And that way, they and all their bad debts get filled in and they get bailed out and saved. But the rest of us don't get that money, which, okay, so it's at our expense in whatever degree there's inflation, and that sucks, but it's actually better that way, because if they really were loaning out all that money to everybody, they would have completely and totally destroyed the entire economy by now with rampant, you know, double-digit inflation worse than the 70s or something like that. But so, where does that leave us then? Because, like you're saying, they can't unwind it. And but they can still only print so much before the prices of everything just go completely out of control.
Scott, you raised several good points. Let me try off the top of my head to address it. First of all, the paying of interest by the Federal Reserve to the banks on their excess reserves was authorized by Congress. So
okay.
We're referring to here is a situation where Ben Bernanke is creating this money out of thin air, as the old saying goes, lending it to his banker buddies at 0%, and part of that money they're using to buy treasuries. As they're unloading their toxic mortgage-backed securities onto the Fed and eventually onto the American taxpayer, that's creating excess reserves. And Ben Bernanke, despite all this talk about helping the economy, that he's doing all this to helping the economy, and if you'll recall, you know, all these bailouts, it was to keep the credit lines open and to keep food on the table and the ATM machines working. And yet, while they were making those statements, they were actually paying the banks interest on those excess reserves, in essence paying them, excuse me, not to lend the money out. So that's the first point.
Right.
The second point, thanks to people like John Williams, that original basket of goods and services that was out designed to tally the rate of inflation, when the CPI originally was a metric that was designed to tell us how much we had to spend in order to maintain a fixed standard of living. But as the inflation problem grew, they began to manipulate the CPIU. Under Richard Nixon is when they introduced the concept of the core inflation, and that's when they took out the food and the fuel. So now that CPIU is X food and fuel. Then there were several other manipulations. During the Clinton administration, they convened a commission called the Boskins Commission. This is when we had Bill Clinton, a Democrat, in the White House, and a Republican Congress. And the mission of the Boskins Commission was to devise another metric to further understate the rate of inflation. And then that's when we got the notion of semi-substitution, and then hedonics, and then eventually geometric progression. On the substitution-based method, that they will assume that suppose the original basket of goods and services used to be an airplane ticket from New York to Los Angeles, but now that has become cost prohibitive, so they assume with substitution-based accounting that instead of flying from New York to L.A., you'll now take a bus. The bus was actually cheaper than the original plane ticket, so now they understate the inflation, or if steak gets too expensive, you're going to switch to hot dogs. So they began manipulating that number with hedonics. That's the notion where, okay, let's say the iPad. I remember William Dudley, head of the New York so-called Federal Reserve Bank, held up an iPad 2, and because in his view it was deemed 35% better than the iPad 1, well, in the hedonics adjustment, even though the iPad 2 may have cost the same or a little bit more than the original iPad, since William Dudley deemed it to be 35% better, they now took the iPad and said it was 35% cheaper. With with the geometric progression, they give more weight to things going down in price than they do going up in price. So now, even though using all of these shenanigans, it's still higher than what they want to tell us. That's the reason we're beginning to hear about the chain-weighted CPIU, and that will further understate the inflation rate. But that original basket of goods and services is still out there. So let's take, for example, the official inflation rate last month, year over year, came out at 1.36%. That's the CPIU as reported. The chain-weighted CPIU came in at 1.31%. So that's a further reduction in the official rate of inflation. If we go back to the way inflation was tallied during the Clinton years, that 1.36% CPIU turns into 4.5%. If we go back to the way they calculated inflation under Ronald Wilson Reagan and Paul Volcker, 9%.
Oh, man.
So the government's response to rising inflation is just to redefine inflation.
Of course. Yeah, just like they've redefined freedom and everything else in the world. Well, okay, wow, so really 9%, huh, under Reagan's stats?
Under Reagan's stats last month, year over year, 9%.
Okay, now, I'm not saying that surprised me at all, because the cost of living is just going up all over the place. I don't have the calculator to do the market basket myself, but I sure believe you, because what you say sure sounds right, and I'm sure... Could you give us a good footnote where we can check the different calculations, the way that, you know, the way they keep changing it, the way you described there?
John Williams at ShadowStats, ShadowStats.com, is probably the foremost tracker of these government statistics. There is also a publication out of the UK, but the one that most of us go to now is ShadowStats.com.
Unreal. All right, now, so wait a minute. If Bernanke is paying every banker in America to just be rich and go on vacation and not loan that money to mom and pop, then why is there so much price inflation?
Well, it's supply,
because it's all
and
based
demand
on the fractional reserve rate. They're loaning that money out to somebody.
Yeah, it's supply and demand. Too many dollars, not enough demand. But there's an underlying trend that's taking place here, too, and that is the loss of reserve status of the U.S. dollar. Now, when I was a child, growing up, you know, the dollar had become the world's reserve currency by virtue of the Bretton Woods Agreement after World War II. And the central banks and other banks around the world held dollars as their reserves. But what we're seeing is a movement away from the dollar as the world's reserve currency. You know, and you mentioned Bob Murphy. Bob's been a guest on my show as well, and I like the way he said it. As with the dollar being the reserve currency of the world, it was almost as if the world were paying us some sort of tribute. And where the other countries in the world had to always convert their currency into dollars in order to do trade internationally, as we lose our reserve status, and it's happening on a daily basis, these countries are now trading with each other, bypassing the U.S. dollar. You know, I had read a stat that over 90% of all the $100 bills ever created are actually outside the United States. As we lose reserve status, as people no longer need to hold dollars in reserve, those dollars are all coming back into the United States.
Right. So, and it's mom and pop are the ones who are left holding the bag at the very end.
Scott, you know, Sunday morning, I went and bought a basket of groceries. It cost me $100.90. And I was talking to the clerk, who was a Turkish fella at the tender young age of 24, and he was commenting about how in his 3 years working at that grocery store, how shocked he was to see the prices rise. So I did quick math, and, you know, that basket of groceries that I bought this past Sunday for $100.90 in 1980 would have cost me slightly under $6. And all the while, we've had no inflation. But let's talk about Ben Bernanke's target rate. You know, they used to use that PCE, Personal Consumption Expenditure Index, that he's tied to, which includes all those manipulations to tally inflation that I mentioned earlier. It used to be that that was the rate at which they would not exceed. Now, if you heard him Wednesday, that is his target rate. In his view, and in the view of those bankers, those central bankers, we don't have enough inflation. So they're going to inflate to get us to 2%. Well, their 2% in reality is 9%. based on the 1980 calculation.
Yeah.
But give him his 2% for a minute. Let's just assume that is an accurate figure. Well, 2% compounded over 10 years is 24%. So that means over 20 years, you're looking at 48%. Over the 30 years, going back to that 1980 $6 basket of goods and services that I mentioned, you know, we're now up in the 60 to 70% range. But the real rate of inflation has been significantly greater. So imagine that you're a baby boomer who's retired right now. You've saved all your life. First of all, you're not getting any interest income,
right?
Because of what they've done, you know, to the interest rates, the deliberate manipulation of the interest rates, but the purchasing power of your dollars are plummeting. So if you live 20 years, even if you give Ben Bernanke his 2%, then what you have saved for your retirement will buy half as much 20 years from now as it's buying today. But the real rate of inflation, you know, you might be left with 10 or 15 cents on the dollar. And that's what's happening to our middle class. The cost of everything is rising. Our incomes are not keeping pace.
Yep. Well, and, you know, it's been 10 years. I'm sure this is still true. But last time I saw, they said real wages haven't gone up in America since 1972 or some crap like that.
Yeah, since the early 1970s. That is a fact.
Man, if only there was a way to make everyone hate that Richard Nixon, you know? Oh, wait. He's the one guy that it's okay for everyone to hate. The one politician it's okay. Well, so what's the real unemployment rate? And, in fact, if you could, tell it to me in the way that they calculated it in the in the 1930s.
Okay, well, as you know, because we've
Oh, and real quick, because we're almost out of time.
Okay. I have the fortune every first Friday of the month to interview a fellow by the name of Keith Hall, who ran the Bureau of Labor Statistics for 5 years. He stepped down February of last year. Keith has taught me how to read the unemployment reports. The U3, the one the media continuously calls the unemployment rate, merely are the number of people who have been unemployed for 26 weeks or less, and who have actively looked for a job in the last 4 weeks. It is a tiny, narrow slice. Once you go unemployed for 26 weeks and a day, you're no longer counted in the U3. You could be counted in the U6, which counts them up to 365 days. Once you go to 366 days, you're no longer counted in the U3 or the U6. The average unemployed person in this country right now has been unemployed for 44 weeks, which means they're not even in the official rate of unemployment. The go-to statistics for the career statisticians in the BLS is the employment-to-population ratio. Last month, in May, that hit a low, a 34-year low, at 58.6%. Now, that doesn't mean, by extension, that 41% unemployment rate, because there's a certain percentage of those people who really don't want to work. So for that, we look to the participation rate. That came in at 63% and change. The real rate of unemployment is somewhere north of 22%, south of 30%, Scott. And that's according to the BLS. That's
right,
not my number.
I just wanted to reiterate what you said there. This doesn't include grandmas and kindergartners. This doesn't include people who are paraplegic and live with their parents. These are people who would like to be working if they could be.
Exactly. That's the participation rate. The BLS wants to get away from the U3. It is a meaningless number. For lack of a better description, it is a political number.
Hey, we got to do this more often.
Okay.
Anytime. I like learning this stuff.
All right. Later.
Wasn't that great, everybody? I think so, too. Thanks, Alan. Appreciate it.
Bye.
Everybody, that's the great Alan Butler. He's the host of Butler on Business and hosts my show at his network, the Liberty Express, at libertyexpressradio.com. We'll be right back after this. ScottHorton.org. Oh, man, I'm late. Sure hope I can make my flight.
Stand there.
Me? I am standing here.
Come here.
Okay.
Hands up, turn around.
Whoa, easy.
Into the scanner. Ooh, what's this in your pants?
Hey, slow down. It's just my...
Hold it right there. Your wallet has tripped the metal detector. What's this? The Bill of Rights?
That's right. It's just a harmless stainless steel business card-sized copy of the Bill of Rights from SecurityEdition.com. They're for exposing the TSA as a bunch of liberty-destroying goons who've never protected anyone from anything. Sir, now give me back my wallet and get out of my way. Got a plane to catch.
Have a nice day.
Play a leading role in the security theater with the Bill of Rights Security Edition from SecurityEdition.com. It's the size of a business card, so it fits right in your wallet, and it's guaranteed to trip the metal detectors wherever the police state goes. That's SecurityEdition.com. And don't forget their great Fourth Amendment socks.
Hey guys, I got his laptop.
Admit it, our public debate has been reduced to reading each other's bumper stickers. Scott Horton here for LibertyStickers.com. I made up most of them, and most of those when I was mad as hell about something. So if you hate war, empire, central banking, cops, Republicans, Democrats, gun grabbers, and status of all stripes, go to LibertyStickers.com, and there's a good chance you'll find just what you need for the back of your truck. Own a bookstore? Sell guns at the show? Get the wholesaler's deal. Buy any 100 stickers and they drop down in price to a dollar a piece. You can spread the contempt and make a little money too. That's LibertyStickers.com. Everyone else's stickers suck. Hey, you own a business? Maybe we should consider advertising on the show. See if we can make a little bit of money. My email address is scott@scotthorton.org. All right, y'all, welcome back to the show. I'm your host, Scott Horton. This is the Scott Horton Show. Yeah, so I should do some more interviews like that more often. I really like Alan. And he had told me before about how he had somehow made friends with the former head of the Bureau of Labor Statistics. And then, I guess, once that guy left government work, he's like, let me tell you how this really works, pal. And taught him how to read in detail, how to read all the government unemployment reports. You know, read through the legalese for what it really says. And, boy, what did he just say? 23% or 25 or some horrible freaking thing? And my problem is, I believe it. I think that sounds about right to me. People are hurting bad. And so, of course, the government... since it's all their fault, they lie about it all damn day. You know? First of all, they lie to you about whose fault it is when it's theirs, the government, the central bankers. They're the ones who've done this to us. I mean, because the private bankers that they work with and them thought it was a great idea. Don't get me wrong. It is a fascist system, not a socialist one. The system of American money, I mean. Central banking. But so since it's their fault and since TV is loyal only to the state, the entire discussion of the economy, unemployment, inflation, these most important points, on television, in public, among official type people, whatever, it's, mired in nonsense, which makes me wonder, like, what do the billionaires read? You know what I mean? Is it Barron's or one of those that you heard of but never read before? Is that one of those actually gets it right? Or I guess not. And that's why all the billionaires made so many bad bets. And if they had to take responsibility, would have lost so much money in the giant housing bubble. They're all vulgar Keynesians too. Anyway, hey, listen. I don't know. I'm always torn. I don't ever want to sound patronizing or whatever. I'm just some regular guy up here trying to do what I do, you know? I'm like Norm MacDonald. What? I'm just a guy over here with the, you know, thinking a thing and saying it. That's all. So, I kind of talk like I assume that everybody already understands about central banking. But you know what? Some of you may be new to this subject. And you may not even know why it should be interesting to you at all. And I'll tell you why. Real simply, too, and real short. You'll have to do the homework yourself. What they call it is the Austrian school theory of the business cycle. Doesn't that sound boring and stupid? Here's what it means. It means that the government causes the giant boom and the giant bust. Remember when the economy seemed like it was really good, and then all of a sudden it got really bad. And it seemed like it was really good again, and then it got really bad again. That was the government jerking you around. That was the government central bank inflating, expanding bank credit, causing rising prices in all sectors and especially some sectors. Seems like the stock market always benefits the most somehow, doesn't it? Huh. Housing and dot-coms and whatever. And then, but what happens to a bubble? Eventually it pops. It's such a great term, a bubble, for this kind of economic activity. It's the perfect one. If they hadn't already named them that, that's what I would call them. Yeah, it's a bubble full of hot air. There's no substance to it. When you're on the top of the bubble, it seems like you're really smart, or else how'd you get up on top of the bubble? Look at how much money I'm making. I must really know what I'm doing. Pop. Splash. And then you're lucky if you don't drown. And it's all the government's fault. I mean, that's it. Okay? Here's the fact that matters. If you want to stop the boom and the bust, which, you know, you couldn't overstate how horrible this is. Have trillions of dollars destroyed at a time. People's lives ruined in ways you can't imagine. You know, the murder, suicides, and all that. That's only part of it, right? Just think of all the bankruptcies, all the bad bets, all the broken relationships, marriages, and kids in foster care, and just social disruption all over the freaking place. Individual disruption. Because of the cluster of errors caused by the government's inflation, expansion of bank credit, and the boom and the bust that they bring on to all of us. There's just no way to overstate it. And then, geez, I went off on a tangent. I was going to say something else there real quick, but I forget. But anyway, point being is that it's really exciting, man. It's the biggest crime ever, like bigger than World War II. It's the biggest scam in the history of the world. The central bank, and particularly America's central bank. And again, because it's all their fault, TV will never give it to you straight. Never, never. You're going to have to read the case against the Fed by Murray Rothbard. You're going to have to do some looking around on your own. And by the way, avoid the populist right, pro Abraham Lincoln, pro John Kennedy, greenbacks, and all that crap. They don't know what they're talking about. It's the Austrian school. Those are the guys who know what they're talking about. Mises.org, for one example. For the best examples. Those are the guys who are good on central banking, especially the Rothbardians. So, anyway, I know what I was going to say. If you want an end to the boom and bust, you need a gold standard. That's it. You need to ban the government forever from being able to create money out of nothing. Now, there are libertarians who favor fractional reserve banking as long as it's free market fractional reserve banking. As long as there is not a government to be the lender of last resort. As long as when a business that engages in fractional reserve banking has to go bankrupt when they make bad decisions, then that's fine. And as long as they're not defrauding their customers, but everybody knows the game they're playing. I think this is David Henderson's thing. He says, you know, the airlines, they oversell tickets, but they know that some people aren't going to show up. And then occasionally they overbook. But everybody knows that going into the deal. And so it's not quite that they sold the same ticket to two people, or even though they did, everybody was kind of cool with it in the first place. You know? It'd be like if there was a restaurant where you kind of had to put your, it was such a busy place, you had to put your name in the hat, pay in advance, and then, but only by lottery do you get to sit. You might have to pay for your meal, but not get one, or something. As long as you know that's the gimmick at this restaurant, because they're busy as hell around lunch rush, or whatever, and you know that's the deal when you put your money in, and okay, you bought more meals than you get, but it's not fraud because it's the deal. Anyway, There are other libertarians who say no way, it has to be 100% gold standard. It's basically a Hayek versus Rothbard argument, right? And on this one, Rothbard, the anarchist, was the one who said 100% gold standard ought to be the law. And it was Hayek who said there ought to be competing currencies, even inflationary ones, right? I'm an amateur at this stuff, but I'm pretty good for an amateur. By the way, hey, help me out. Go over to TalkStream Live. I'm doing real good. I've apparently been up in the second row all day today. And at one point, I was up on in sixth place. Second place on the second row. But that's pretty good. And apparently, there are others taking note, and there's a little bit of a battle going on here. Because apparently this lady, Tammy Bruce, has told her audience that they ought to go bumrush TalkStreamLive.com and put her up in second place, and they did. But that's pretty good, man. I'll take sixth or eighth place or whatever on TalkStream Live on a regular basis. I think that's all right. I'm doing pretty good over there. And I appreciate you guys going over there and clicking away. I mean, don't overdo it. I'm sure they can tell if you're cheating, you know, IP addresses or whatever. I don't want you to cheat. Just go click on it once. TalkStreamLive.com. There I am. My wife took that picture. I remember that. It was at KPFK in LA. All right, so I got a ton more news, and oh my God, it's almost time to go to Peter Ludlow already, so I better stop bellyaching about central banking, last hour's subject, and talk about other things. Let me tell you this about the NSA, and this is a morality-based rant rather than an informative thing, but I'm going to try to make it real quick, and that is that I've always assumed that it was like this. Ever since they first invented cell phones, I knew they can triangulate your position, and they can save where everybody's position ever was, and they can save it for always. Their government, they get their money for free by taxation and or inflation and or borrowing it from the Chinese or Koreans or whatever, and I guess mostly borrowing it from the Fed, which creates it out of nothing. They can buy all the hard drives they need, right? Even when a hard drive only had 20 gigs on it or whatever, that's not a problem for them. They can, I assume, since the first time I went to Northern Light Search Engine or Yahoo or whatever back in 1997, that, yeah, of course the NSA is keeping this. They built the entire telecommunications network for the world, especially for America, and most of the telecommunications network for the world is based out of America. The National Security Agency was there all along. You know, Ma Bell, AT&T, it used to be a felony, a federal felony, to try to compete with them. They had the government monopoly. And then it was only when government allowed others into the market that they were allowed in. Well, guess what? They've been on terms and conditions all along. Terms and conditions like the NSA owns your ass or find another industry to be in. And it has always been that way. And in fact, you're kind of ridiculous and simple and naive if you thought that your emails, your phone calls, your Google searches were secure. Because, of course, they're not. The only reason they are is if you are one of these super educated computer geniuses, you know, a level 10 computer nut who really knows how to proxy this, that, and the other thing and encrypt all of his communications 7 ways to Sunday and whatever. I'm not talking to you. You know. I'm talking to just regular folks out there. You are not free. They are spying on you. They're saving everything you do. Every time you spend on your debit card, where you spent and what time and whatever goes on your permanent record forever. Maybe you're a nice law-abiding citizen and you love cops because you watch TV dramas that tell you to love cops all night long, every night when you come home from work at your government job or whatever, and maybe you're not sticking your neck out, but what if you ever do? What if they decide that they want to, as Edward Snowden put it, go back and look at your entire life and scrutinize every decision you ever made because they're saving all of it. And so, this is why we fight, kids. Welcome to the 21st century. Or the end of the last one. I have always assumed that every broadcast I do online or over the FM airwaves or anything else is saved and goes on my permanent record by the National Security Agency. Not that I'm the most interesting person in the world, just that I'm an American. And I am not free. And they are keeping tabs on my ass. Same as yours. But that's why we're here, right? Look, the whole internet was created by the government, mostly to control information so they can better militarize the planet, enslave everybody. And human ingenuity and creativity has turned it around, and now we can use it as a double-edged sword back against them. Do you want to live in a brave new world? If you're lucky, right? You want to live in a 1984 totalitarian slave state until the day they shoot you in the head? Or do you want to be free? Well, if you want to be free, you're going to have to fight back while you still can, and time is running short. Because as everyone now understands, we live in a turnkey totalitarian system right now. They have a grid of total enslavement ready to go. The only question is whether, for example, the NSA can turn all their information over to the DHS and the FBI and your local sheriff's department. But what if your local sheriff's department can go trolling through the last 7 years of all phone records and use NARA software to figure out, you know, which of these patterns is worth looking at when they decide they want to bust everybody's weed connect or they want to bust whoever, anyone who dares commit any offense? That was just my guilty conscience, you know. But anyway, it's not that guilty. When I was 14, a guy on the drag, that's the Guadalupe Street here in Austin, Texas, across from UT. I was about 14, I guess. And some punk rock kid handed me a flyer, said, "Fight back while you still can," and had totalitarian police state, black helicopters and stormtroopers with gas masks and machine guns marching and dark skies. And I thought, hey, great point. Because I don't want to die young. I want to be good, but I don't want to die young. I want to, well, I don't even care how good I am, really. But I want to die of old age. Like, really old age. Because I'm afraid to die. Because I'm a person. I don't want to live in a totalitarian hellhole. And hey, like, young people that I care about, I don't want them to live in a totalitarian hellhole either. Let's keep that old law. The Bill of Rights. Let's do whatever it takes to reinstate, to keep what we have of it and reinstate the rest and hold on to that. Let's not give up that. In fact, let's give up the empire that creates all the excuses for its destruction. And anyway, I don't know. I just kind of got on this trip. I took a little note, why we fight. Because it occurred to me that a lot of people, many, probably millions and millions and millions of Americans are only learning for the first time in the last couple of weeks that the NSA is keeping tabs on them. That if they had been completely paranoid this whole time about their every electronic everything, they would have been right. When Glenn Greenwald looks right in the camera and says, "Oh, I got dozens of stories coming," I believe him. And I think dozens is just a nice way of saying many dozens. I don't know what all Snowden gave to The Guardian, but no one can take it away from them. I mean, The Guardian is a serious-ass institution, man. I don't know what all he gave The Washington Post either, but apparently he gave everything to Greenwald. And what are they going to do? Send in the MI5 to raid and break open the Guardian's safes with explosives or something? I mean, it's just, what are they going to do? Your goose is cooked. Docs are leaked. And I just hope people get madder and madder and madder. I hope people will continue to resist all the smear jobs against Snowden and against Greenwald and whoever. Right? Here's your best smear job that you can do against Greenwald. "Well, he's gay." Oh, wait a minute. It's 2013. And you might as well be the KKK if you think that that's something that you can hold against Glenn Greenwald. Nobody cares about that. In fact, Everybody hates you for accusing him of that. Who cares? How dare you people attack him for his sexuality right now when he's breaking stories about the NSA? That ain't working. That's not going to get you anywhere. What else you got on Greenwald? Well, he can be a little sniffy or something, right? Like, sometimes he gets a little too offended too easily, or I don't know. What are you going to do? What do you got on him? You got nothing on him. You know, he wears nice clothes. He doesn't say bad words. He's a nice little Jewish boy. He's great, man. He's written a decade, 8 years worth of great stuff, starting with the NSA and up to and through today on NSA and spying and probable cause and due process of law. How can you smear Glenn Greenwald? You can't. And the Snowden guy, they already tried to smear him, and it ain't really working. Everybody could tell. He did a smart thing by giving that interview to Greenwald and putting it online before anybody could frame up the argument against him. What a horrible scumbag he must be. He went on camera and he said, you know what, man, I know I'm in trouble for this, but I thought, man, I gotta tell people what's going on here. It's not right that I have all this information. They ain't got it. I gotta give it to the people. They need to know what's going on here. And if I have to never come home again, which I expect I can never come home again, you know what? I don't want to live in a totalitarian police state anyway. And people heard that. People saw that. And they said, you know what? That could be my neighbor. You know? That could be my boy. That could be my cousin, my brother. He got a nice little job working at the NSA. He saw the documents and he went, oh my God, dude. I got to hand this over to Greenwald. Simple as that. Just like Bradley Manning. Pure whistleblower motives. He's not cashing in, working for Vladimir Putin. He's just whistleblowing so the Americans know. And, you know, I was critical there for a time a few days ago. You might have heard me being critical, or you might have seen on Twitter where I was saying, man, why are you notifying the Chinese and the Russians of things? Screw them. But then I read his questions and answers at The Guardian about that. He said, I'm not letting the Chinese and the Russians know things. Not really. What I'm trying to do is let the American people know. Who's waging cyber war? They cry wolf about China all day. And yeah, of course, China's trying to hack into American computers from time to time and whatever. But the Americans are the leaders of cyber war on this planet, and there just ain't no doubt about that. We're attacking them all day, and we're in no position to cry about what they're doing to us back in retaliation. And then when it came to the whole thing about spying on the Russians in Britain and working with the Brits about that, that was all in violation of the Vienna Convention and diplomatic niceties and whatever. And at least he claims, and it seems plausible to me, I mean, what other benefit does he have? You show me where he cashed a check from a foreign state or something. Otherwise, I'm taking a face value explanation. He thought the American people needed to know that their government was kind of picking a fight with Russia and China for no reason. You know, Cold War's over. And no, Putin's not a great man. And he's one of the meanest politicians in the world and whatever, fine. But that doesn't mean that his state needs to be in any way even a frenemy of ours. No, we're not allies and we shouldn't be allies. But we should just be friends with the Russians and we don't need trouble with them. And if there's anything that they need to spy on Dmitry Medvedev about, it's about America intervening where we don't belong in the first place and what the Russians' reaction to that might be. So, anyway. More stories coming. And by the way, there is a new one today. Revealed the top secret rules. This came out last night at The Guardian. Revealed the top secret rules that allow NSA to use U.S. data without a warrant. By Glenn Greenwald and James Ball. But, you know, rather than going through all the details, you can just read that yourself at The Guardian. What I really just wanted to point out was that, yeah, it's an emergency. Yeah, this is the end of the USA. Unless and until people care enough. And see, that's the thing. I'm a real Ron Paulian on this issue, man. I really think that Americans, just like everybody else, unfortunately, collectively, we get the government that maybe not that we deserve, but that we demand. And people want to be taken care of from womb to tomb, and they want the government to protect them all day long from the Al-Qaeda guys that we're backing in Syria or whatever it is right now, that our government's backing in Syria right now, then that's what they'll get, a totalitarian state. No government will ever tell you, they might tell you as an individual customer to piss off, but they will never tell the American society, oh no, we don't want to, you know, grab that power. You know, they're going to take advantage of whatever you give them, and if you give them an inch, they're going to take a mile, no matter what. And in fact, that's what Ron Paul said last week, right? If you give them an inch, they'll take a mile, and they'll always paint themselves as heroes. They'll always say that what they do protects us. As William Pitt said 300 years ago, necessity is the argument of tyrants and the creed of slaves. Yeah. I heard it all before about how necessary this, that, and the other thing is. But it's not. And if we live in a culture where we just reject that kind of crap, where we don't care if 9/11 was an inside job or not, because we know that it might as well have been. We know that Dick Cheney is far more evil than Osama bin Laden. Dick Cheney killed 100 times as many civilians as Osama bin Laden. Jeez, more than that. We know that even if they didn't have, even if they didn't turn a blind eye at all, that of course they're going to cynically exploit that tragedy in every possible way for as long as they can. Grab whatever power they can, launch whatever bonus wars they want, restrict your freedom in whatever possible way. Because they, the U.S. government, they are your, the American people, enemy. They are out to get you. They hate you more than Osama bin Laden hates you. You know, bin Laden's whole thing was to kill Americans so as to get a reaction, so as to screw up our government, because he hated our government so much. He just didn't care about us. And he did say, well, we pay taxes, so we deserve it, or whatever crap. So I hope he's having fun drowning in hell forever and ever, that guy. But all I'm saying is that any accusation that he could have made against our government couldn't be severe enough for how evil it really is. Not that that would justify attacking civilians any more than what he did to us justified attacking civilians in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, Yemen, Somalia, anywhere else. Hell, we're fighting a war for him right now, for his ghost in Syria, just like we fought one in Libya for him 2 years ago. But anyway, so there you go. Sorry, I was going to try to keep it short, but I can't. It's an emergency. Your government is out to get you. They've disregarded each and every last letter of the Constitution years and years ago. And if we don't all start changing our mind about the respect that we hold for them or the legitimacy of the actions that they say that they have to take or the honesty in the reasons that they invoke for why they have to take them, then we are going to suffer. We are going to continue to see our society tear itself apart. You think 20-anything percent unemployment can go on for the long term in this country and have this country even still be this country? Think you can have a authorization to use military force against every last woman and child on earth, anywhere on earth, for just decades and decades and be free? You're going to have to change your mind about it. And you know what? The American people, I don't mean to sell everybody so short. The polls say 70% are opposed to intervening further in Syria on behalf of the Mujahideen. My God, give yourself a round of applause, Americans. That is just beautiful. I think that might be the greatest thing I ever heard or something. Are you kidding me? Oh, man, I gotta go. We'll be right back with Peter Ludlow about Barrett Brown right after this.
So you're a libertarian, and you don't believe the propaganda about government awesomeness you were subjected to in fourth grade. You want real history and economics. Well, learn in your car from professors you can trust with Tom Woods's Liberty Classroom. And if you join through the Liberty Classroom link at scotthorton.org, we'll make a donation to support The Scott Horton Show. Liberty Classroom, the history and economics they didn't teach you.
Hey everybody, Scott Horton here. Ever think maybe your group should hire me to give a speech? Well, maybe you should. I've got a few good ones to choose from, including how to end the war on terror, the case against war with Iran, central banking in war, Uncle Sam and the Arab Spring, the ongoing war on civil liberties, and of course, why everything in the world is Woodrow Wilson's fault. But I'm happy to talk about just about anything else you've ever heard me cover on the show as well. So check out youtube.com/ScottHortonShow for some examples, and email scott@scotthorton.org for more details. See you there. Hey y'all, Scott here. First of all, thanks to the show's sponsors and donors who make it possible for me to do this. Secondly, I need more sponsors and more donors if the show is to continue. ScottHorton.org/donate has all the links to use PayPal, Give.org, Google Wallet, WePay.com, and even Bitcoins to make a donation in any amount. You can also sign up for monthly donations of small and medium-sized amounts through PayPal and Give.org. Again, that's ScottHorton.org/donate for all the links. To advertise on the site or the show, email me, scott@scotthorton.org. Y'all, welcome back to the show. I'm Scott Horton. This is my show, The Scott Horton Show. I'm at scotthorton.org, noagendastream.com, Anomaly Radio, and all over the place. Full interview archive, more than 2,800 interviews now, going back to 2003, are all available at scotthorton.org. You can sign up for the podcast feed there, all the interview archives if you want. Whole show archives are there too. Follow me on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube at /ScottHortonShow. Et cetera, ad infinitum. All right, so our next guest on the show is Peter Ludlow. He is a professor at Northwestern University, their Department of Philosophy there, and he's got a piece at thenation.com, The Strange Case of Barrett Brown. Welcome to the show. How are you doing?
Hey, thanks a lot, Scott.
Very happy to have you here. Very happy to see this great article. I really like Barrett Brown, and I can't stand to see what's happening to him, and I guess I just take pleasure in seeing his story covered at all. It's the only hope he's got of freedom is for his story to be out there wide enough that the government's efforts against him become such a laughing stock that they finally have to back down. Basically, as far as I can tell, that's the only hope he's got. So yeah, this
Scott,
great article
where you
simply recite all the facts of the case or do a great job in explaining just how horrible the government's position is on this thing.
I had a question, Scott. Did you actually know him?
I've interviewed him a couple
of
times. Yeah,
okay.
I've never met him in person, okay. But I've interviewed him a couple of times back in 2010, 2011.
Right. Okay.
And, it's kind of a complicated thing, but go ahead and tell the story. You do such a great job of telling the story in here. Give the audience, I guess, the short version, and we can go back and follow up on all the important points to hit.
Sure. Let's do a short version of the story. Barrett Brown is a very interesting journalist. He's written some nice pieces in Vanity Fair and places like Huffington Post and The Guardian. And at a certain point around 2010, he got interested in Anonymous and the work they were doing in the Arab Spring. And that sort of took him further into Anonymous and reporting on it. He was basically writing a book about Anonymous at that point. And there were a couple of hacks of interest that were directed at private intelligence firms. One was a firm named H.B. Gary. The other was a firm named Stratfor. and they yielded massive troves of emails. In the HB Gary case, I think there was like 70,000 emails, and in the Stratfor case, there were something like 5 million emails. And Barrett had a wiki set up called Project PM, where he and a number of his associates were basically working on an analysis of what they were digging up from those emails that were released. And the crucial thing to understand is that Barrett wasn't involved in any hacking at all. And in fact, what he did do is take a URL, right, a URL to the location of the material. And I don't know if it was on Pastebin or WikiLeaks or where, but he copied the URL from a chat channel, and he pasted the URL into a chat channel for the editorial board of his Project PM. And that seems to be the principal thing that got him in trouble, which is right now he's looking at something like 105 years in prison. And the key charges are a number of charges involving alleged credit card fraud. And the whole idea is that there were unencrypted credit card numbers in this data dump from the Stratfor hack. And they're claiming that by copying and pasting the link to where all those emails were located, he was in fact engaged in credit card fraud with his associates. And so that's his situation. He's sitting in federal custody in Texas, down by you somewhere, and he is looking at a total of 105 years in prison.
Okay, so now, when it comes to that that original charge, I guess we've got to talk about the whole FBI thing and all that in a second, but that main charge about the copying and pasting of the link, the only thing they're able to make out of that is, or that they're trying to make out of that, is credit card fraud. They're not trying to pretend that this means that he participated in the hack, which, as you say, someone else has already pleaded guilty to.
That's correct.
And he's a journalist. He's not a hacker. Barrett couldn't have broken into Stratfor if he'd tried all week long, right?
No, he couldn't hack his way out of a paper bag.
Right.
No. I mean, I think that everyone realizes that.
Right.
I don't think the government is conceding that he is a journalist or that Project PM was a journalistic enterprise. So they're claiming that Project PM, which you could go and, you know, you can all go Google it, just Project PM, and it'll take you there. They're claiming that it was a kind of criminal enterprise. And they're also disputing that he's any sort of journalist, which is peculiar, because what do you call someone who publishes articles in, you know, The Guardian and places like that? You know,
terrorist!
I guess so. I guess.
Well, okay,
that's
and now...
coming.
So now, okay, yeah. Tell me this now. Let's take politics out of this for a second. And, well, I don't know how to really construct a hypothetical without the you know, political motivations of the people involved here in the first place, but I want to try to narrow it down to just the behavior of copying and pasting that link. When you talk to the legal eagles about this, would they concede that the feds could possibly have a case that this would amount to him conspiring with those who did the hack to knowingly get someone's credit card used? You know what I mean? Like, they have their court precedents in a case just like this, sort of that kind of thing.
Yeah, but look, I don't think they, by they I mean the Justice Department, I don't think they're thinking in terms of, do I have a case? It's, can I cobble something together which threatens this person with life in prison and force him to plea to something? So the whole idea of, is there a case or did he do something wrong? That sort of thinking is just out the window. We're living in an age where people rig up, you know, some sort of preposterous charge like we have in this case. And it's a low likelihood that you could, you know, win with that case, but someone is gambling with their life in effect. And so you force a plea to whatever it's going to be. You know, Jeremy Hammond pled to 10 years made a plea that which could put him away for 10 years. No sane person would think that there's actually a case here, but that's not the issue. It's like a game of chance. Like, if I can threaten you with life in prison, maybe I can get you to plead to, you know, however many years he's eventually going to do here.
Right. Yeah, in other words, it's just a political prosecution. The same kind of thing where John Kerry would be screaming his little head off about it if it was any other country in the world.
That's true. I think, though, that when you say it's a prosecution, that in a certain sense, when you say it's a prosecution, you have an image of some sort of trumped-up kangaroo court with an actual trial. And it's, we don't even have that facade in this case. I mean, I don't think these things are actually going to go to trial. It's like what they did with Aaron Schwartz, for example. I mean, if you remember that case, right?
They hounded him to death.
Yeah. And he was looking at whatever it was, 35 years, something like that. And it becomes, there's this sort of prosecutorial discretion that we have now, wherein basically, if you think about it, you know, everyone is technically a felon at this point. I mean, so start with the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, which is the one that they used to get or to go after Aaron Schwartz, which the Justice Department interprets that to mean that if you violated the terms of service of some computer program, you are in violation of the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. I'm sure you've been through this on your show before, right? So in effect, when you click that box that says, you know, when you go on OkCupid and you say, I'm not going to lie about my age, right? And if I lie about my age, I violated the terms of service and I am technically a felon. Well, in an age when everyone is technically a felon, that means that prosecutors have this ability to go after anyone who happens to be too much of a gadfly or too much of a pain in the ass system. And I think this is just one piece of evidence. This is just one example of many, many recent cases like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and again, where they know their intention is never to really have a jury trial of any kind. They just pile on charge after charge after charge after charge until you just finally lay down and say, fine, whatever, go ahead. Who do you want me to snitch on? What do I got to do? Don't kill me.
I think that's right. I don't think there's any intent at all to have a trial. I mean, just in general, 95% of all cases, if that, or 95% or more, are pled out at this point. So only 5% of these cases where someone's charged that people go to court. And it raises questions about, you know, what kind of legal system do we actually have here if things aren't being adjudicated at trial and, you know, people are concocting these sort of crazy interpretations of the law to, like, threaten people with 35 years or 105 years or whatever it is and just sort of bully them into either accepting a plea or suicide or whatever it's going to be.
Yeah, yeah. All right, so now talk about the whole thing with the FBI agent. Is that still one of the charges that he threatened the FBI agent?
Yeah, that's one of them. So in addition to these charges that have to do with various forms of credit card fraud, there is an obstruction of justice charge, and there's a charge relating to a threat against an FBI agent, and those two are related. At some point, now, as I understand the details, it goes something like this. The FBI acquired a subpoena to look at his computer or computers, and I believe that when they came to look for him, he wasn't at home. He was at his mom's house. And he, at least the story I get from his side, is that he stashed his computer at his mom's house. The police came to his mom's house with a search warrant and a subpoena for the contents of the stuff, and they charges mom with obstructing a federal investigation, obstruction of justice, threatened her with years in prison, and she pled. to, I believe, a year of probation. But when his mom was a target of the investigation, and apparently his mom was really, really messed up about this, he flipped out. I mean, they basically found a way to push his buttons to the point where he flipped out. So he uploaded these kind of incoherent videos on YouTube, and one of which he says, oh, he threatens the FBI agent who's going after his mother. And he says, well, I'm going to go after you. I'm going to destroy you. And by that, I don't mean I'm going to kill you, but I'm going to look into you, and I'm going to look into your kids, too. How do you like those apples? And so that got him charge of threatening a federal officer.
And, you know, the thing of it is, and people can go and look at it on YouTube, and as you watch it, you will think, oh, man, just stop yelling into the camera now. Oh, no, don't keep talking. I really wish he had not done that or whatever. But it is clear in context. And when he got, I forgot his exact words, but whatever, I'm going to destroy you or some very vague term like that. But it is so obvious that what he's talking about is, I'm going to Google the hell out of you, and I'm going to post what I find on a page on the internet somewhere. This is not a threat.
Yeah, I don't think it's any sort of – it's certainly not a physical threat. The other thing you have to put in context here is that the guy is he was a recovering heroin addict, and he had been on Suboxone for a couple years, and for whatever reason – in the middle of all this, he had gone off his Suboxone, so he was going through withdrawals from that, and he was completely flipped out. I mean, he was out of his mind when he's posting this stuff. But I agree with you. It's like he's totally tweaked out, I mean, flipped out when he's, like, posting this, but it's also obvious he's not going to, like, it's not an actual threat. I mean, I don't think anyone could, like, look at that and say it's a real threat. But obviously, you know, the FBI can take that and go to a judge and say, look, we got to go get this guy. And they did.
And he's just being held without bail now or what?
That's correct. Yep.
Because of this terrible threat.
Yeah, as a general rule, these people get held without bail. There's a sort of level of paranoia about anyone who's associated with, forget about whether they're hackers, anyone who's associated with the hacking community, there's a kind of level of paranoia that, you know, they can do things like start World War III by whistling into the telephone or something like
right.
that. I mean,
yeah.
that was an actual case some years ago.
Yeah, you know, Cracked has a good one. The top 10 things that movies think computers can do, like control every red light in America from a laptop or whatever. And it's like, no, only in your imagination and in Hollywood. That's it.
Yeah, yeah. But it shows there's a kind of level of ignorance about technology that sort of runs through the legal system, especially when you get to the bench and judges basically, you know, they're still trying to figure out how to program a VCR, and like no one even has VCRs anymore, so they could stop trying and try something else.
Yeah.
And so you get, you know, us prosecutors are generally smart enough to know that judges don't know anything about technology, and they could put the fear of God into a judge just by, you know, talking about some very rudimentary tool like Tor, for example. I mean, that was one that came up in the case of Jeremy Hammond's trial. The judge was very concerned that he was using this program Tor, and, you know, I mean, like, you know, most college kids, I think, know how to use Tor, but it was just a total mystery to the judge. And this is one of the problems that that people are facing here.
Yeah, well, it's amazing. Now, so they try to take his money away. Say, oh, no, you can't have a defense fund, but then they gave it back, right?
Well, they had raised something. I mean, they haven't raised that much money, but at a certain point, they had raised $20,000 for his defense fund, and then they froze it. I have no idea what they were thinking there. I mean, they thought it was going to be used for some nefarious purposes. I mean, I have no idea what that was about. I have no idea what the judge is thinking in this case. I mean, it almost seems like the judge is clueless. I mean, on many, many levels.
But he's got some good lawyers now, right?
Yeah, that's right. He's got like a kind of a strong legal team right now, and I hope things work out well for him.
Yeah, I mean, I forget the guy. He was famous for defending somebody else.
Guantanamo. He was with the Advocate General thing. Swift, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, he's the guy that won the Hamdan case.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So that speaks well of him. You know, I like the sound of that. If anybody's got a chance of standing up to the government on this. I mean, a lot of times it really just does come down to the personality of the lawyer. You know what I mean? I always think of the Randy Weaver case where, man, they had the entire weight of the state against him. And that lawyer, the guy with the tassels on his jacket, can't remember his name anymore. Yeah. He went in there and just tore them apart and didn't even put on a defense. He was done when he was done with his last cross-examination. And that was it.
Huh.
You know?
Yeah.
And that happens from time to time where a lawyer just gets in there, like Dick DeGaren or one of these guys who's just a super, you know, like a pro basketball player, only a lawyer, right? That much better than all the rest of them, who waltzes right in there and just tears the government to shreds and walks out in victory. It does happen from time to time.
Yeah. The problem is we don't have enough of those lawyers.
Yeah, no,
don't. There's too many people in jail and not enough lawyers that are, like, able to, like, help out with this. And
I think Cletus on The Simpsons says, I want that lawyer from TV with the tassels and the cowboy hat. Like, yeah, I don't know his name either, but yeah, I want that guy. The guy that got Randy Weaver off.
Yeah, I remember, yeah. Yeah.
Tassels. Anyway, so, well, you know, I don't know. You know, part of here's something to talk about from this article here is this whole new culture, this whole new aspect of society that never existed before. These anonymous hacktivists, these level 12 computer geniuses who really can protect their identities while they communicate with each other and do these hacks like against H.B. Gary and against Stratfor and others who deserve it. And I mean, it doesn't seem to me like they're going away. Maybe the FBI can crack down and get one or two at a time, but it doesn't seem like they could ever destroy this movement. It's on now. They got the masks from V for Vendetta and everything.
I would say that, people have been a little bit careless about talking about what they're doing and so forth. And it seems to me that, these events are not really going to scare anyone off of these kinds of hacks, but probably just make people more cautious and more careful. I think the other element of this is that part of what these hacks have revealed is really the real story here, I think, which is this whole business with these private intelligence companies and how they're basically carrying out psyops against, you know, the U.S. civilian population. I mean, that's what's really been revealed by all this, and this is why Barrett got into it. I mean, this is what Barrett was really researching was, you know, this is not – everyone thinks about NSA, CIA, FBI, but that's just the tip of the iceberg here. I mean – the U.S. government, 70% of what it spends on intelligence it's outsourced, right? 70% of every dollar spent on intelligence goes to these places like Booz Allen and Stratfor and H.B. Gary and so forth. So there they are out there without any congressional oversight. And what are they doing? What are they up to? And the stuff that Barrett was digging up was the fact that, you know, people like Coca-Cola was going to Stratfor and saying, can you give us information on PETA, you know, the People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals? And then the guy at Stratfor says, oh, yeah, the FBI has a classified file on them. I'll see if I can get it, you know. So it was so weird because it showed that there is this weird symbiotic relationship between these private intelligence companies and the Department of Justice in this case. And it was almost like the Department of Justice was working for Stratfor in a way, because the guy was like, yeah, they have a classified file, I'll get it for you. And, you know, Barrett was going through case after case after case like this, where Dow Chemical was doing surveillance on the Yes Men, where people were doing stuff, you know, making proposals to undermine Chamberwatch, which is a group that monitors the Chamber of Commerce. And, you know, there were weird disinformation campaigns that were being discussed, where they would like create sock puppets and go on social media sites and give the impression of grassroots support. So everyone is freaked out, rightfully so, about the NSA business and Snowden, but that is just the tip of the iceberg. And I think the real story here is, like, what are all these private intel companies doing without any kind of government surveillance going on? You know, I mean, I don't know what kind of oversight they have, maybe none. And they are quite possibly a bigger piece of the intelligence pie than you know, our alphabet soup of, like, FBI, CIA, NSA, DIA, et cetera.
Sure, yeah. I don't have it yet, but I'm trying to get it. There's a brand new book about, is it Tim Shorrock, the new?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I mean, I've seen his book from 2006. Is this the book you're talking about?
Yeah, it could be. And then, of course, you know, even the Washington Post, Arkin and Priest did the Top Secret America and all that. There's been really good, Bartlett and Steele did a great one on SIAC. I mean, there's some good journalism out there against, you know, about how much of the intelligence is outsourced. And you're right, it's most of it.
Yeah.
It's the Cheney model.
Even the New York Times is waking up to this, because their editorial on the 20th was about this. So it's a problem. I mean, people have basically created this Frankenstein monster of these little private CIAs running around the globe, and, like, no one is in control of them. And this is really what Barrett was on about. This, if you go and look at his Project PM site, you'll see there's a lot of material on this.
Right. I mean, really, this is Barrett's problem, right? Is he basically is doing like Julian Assange. He's doing the New York Times, where he's just a journalist, but he's not the one doing the breaking in or the liberating of any documents. He's just making a lot available at once in a way where the New York Times would never do this to Stratfor or the U.S. government and make them look that bad. And in fact, liberate so much information at once that you got to create a whole new program to be able to sift it all and whatever. They just don't know what to do with a guy like Barrett except try to bury him under concrete, because he's just way out ahead of them. But unfortunately, he couldn't get to the Ecuadorian embassy in time.
Well, Barrett is, if he's, you know, there's one way in which he's not like Assange, because Barrett's not making all this information available. All that information is actually on WikiLeaks. So the Stratfor stuff is up on WikiLeaks. So Barrett didn't even do that end of it. All he's doing is providing analysis of it. He's saying he's connecting the dots. He was looking at this stuff.
He's turning the data into information. He's making
That's
it
right.
available to people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
Right.
That's right. And it's weird. It's very weird. It almost seems like it's almost as though the DOJ is working for Stratfor in this case. It's like Stratfor needed to get the toothpaste back in the tube. We can't let all this information out about, you know, what we're up to as private intelligence contractors. And it's like, this guy Barrett Brown, someone's got to put him down. And it's almost like the Department of Justice is running errands for these guys.
Exactly. Since the days of Alexander Hamilton. That's the name of the game. All right, I'm sorry, we gotta go. That's the end of the show.
Bro,
I really appreciate it, Peter.
Yeah,
thanks very much.
All right, bye-bye.
Everybody, that is Peter Ludlow. He is a professor at Northwestern University, and he's got this great one. Man, it's really good. Please go look at it. It's in The Nation, at thenation.com, The Strange Case of Barrett Brown. Free Barrett! Free Brad! See you guys tonight on KPFK, 90.7 FM in LA, 6:30 to 7 Pacific time, or see you Monday back here 11 to 1 Texas time. ScottHorton.org. Welcome to the show. How's it going? I'm Scott Horton. This is my show, the Scott Horton Show. Thanks for tuning in. Should be a good one here in just a few minutes. Nathan Fuller will be joining us. He's covering the Bradley Manning trial for BradleyManning.org. Nathan Fuller. And then got Brianna over there at the ACLU's New York office working on trying to line me up somebody. We got three different very important stories to cover with the ACLU today. If I can swing it. Well, I got a couple hours, so maybe it'll work out. Some very important news. Yeah, I'm a day behind, but I'm going to cover this the DNA ruling with somebody who really knows about it. I think that's something, man. When Antonin Scalia is the last thing protecting your liberty and then he fails, you know? It's bad times. I don't think we should have a Supreme Court. How come the Supreme Court gets to say horrible things about how we all have to live and then it goes? What about screw them and their pretended legitimacy? I know, it's like questioning the virginity of Christ's mom and all of that, right? The virginity, the divinity. What do you mean the Supreme Court is just nine police state hangman rope thugs? And that we'd be better off without their existence at all? Blasphemy. Anyway, well, that's what I think. They are no good. And now, what would it take to undo this decision? I guess I should say this. It's a rhetorical question for you. It'll be an actual question for the ACLU guy. I think Congress would have to pass a law limiting the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. In this case. Or in cases like this. And just say they have no jurisdiction to decide that DNA grabs without warrants or within the purview of the Supreme Court to decide that it could be constitutional under the Fourth Amendment. Something like that? Could you even do that? Could Congress even pass a law like that? And then could anyone imagine in 1 billion years that ever happening?